Okay, thank you, Edna. Well, nice to be with you today, speaking obviously about the difficulties of the left in my country, but also in Latin America, and what are the views that we are looking after. As you can see, my English is not so fluid. I'm trying. If you don't understand something, you just tell me. Well, first of all, I would like to speak about the specific moment that we are living in the, now, because for this year is the bicentenary, 200 years of our independence from Spain. And that's very important, no? But well, the problem is that we are a country that has not achieved a full realization as many other countries in Latin America. With these 200 years of Republican life, we have not known how to face the challenges and the incredible diversity of this country, because Peru, as all the Andean region almost, we have different ways of living, the coast, the Andean zone with the indigenous from the Andean countries, and the Amazon, a big amount of Amazon with the indigenous from the Amazon that has another reality different to the other. Well, this country that is called nation state, as many of you, has nothing about nation state, because we are many nations, and it is not clear in the way of thinking the country. Also, that means that it's a country very much, conservative in many ways, because Peru has been the head of the power of Spain. It was a virreinato. I don't know how to say it in English, but it was all the power was here. So to exercise power has there is a coloniality of the power still now in Peru. I think I would like to end with this little frame about my country to speak about the last periods, no? We have, the left has been very important in Peru in the 80s and part of the 90s. With around 35 or 38% of the population in the period of United Left. But the problem is that there was a division, as luckily that happens with the left in many places. And at the same time, we have the experience of a terrorist group, Shiny Path, during almost 12, 15 years. And that was very, very dramatic. Because in the way that it came out, well, it was a very important confrontation with the police, with a lot of people dead from both sides, as you know. And the problem is that this happened in the period of Fujimori. Fujimori was an informal doctor of the University of Agrarian University that went to election and win. And well, he had votation of the people, because they didn't like the right wing of Vargas Llosa that was there. But the problem is that Fujimori was awful for democracy in the country. He made a coup at 2 years of being in the government. He changed the constitution, and the constitution is really terrible, because it gives all the power to the market and take out many of the rights of the people. And it has a lot of criminal networks and assassinations. He has a very awful situation of forced sterilization for women, and all this. It was a very big mobilization to stop him to continue in the government after 11 years, no, because he wanted also to come to have the third period here. And that was very, very important. We began the process of recovering of the democratic transition. But in this moment, it's only to make a kind of imagine of what is happening. Fujimori is in jail, but he's not the only one. We have another one in jail in the States, Toledo, and waiting for extradition to Peru. We have one president in the house, in the jail, but in the house, not in the jail. One has committed suicide in the moment that they were going to take him to the jail, because it was very clear that there was a lot of corruption in its government. And well, four or five presidents that are in this kind of situation in the last 20 years is kind of too much. But more dramatic, in the last 30 years, we have five presidents, one of them for 3 hours, another one of 5 days, and the population, the incredible mobilization of the population in all the country stopped, and we had the a transition government, and now we have this government, this new government that has arrived. No? But before going to the new situation, the problem of this last instability in the country comes also because of the daughter of Fujimori, of Keiko Fujimori. She has been trying to be in power during the last 3 elections, and the last 2 she has lost with very little margin, and that has make a very difficult situation, because she had majority in the Congress in the last time, and not before, and she just began to confront everything in the government, and finally try to make vacancy against, and well, this guy had to resign. So they try to organize the vice president began to be president for a period, and he was also put in vacancy last year in November, after 1.5 years or 2 years of being in power, and then became one woman president for 3 hours, this guy for 5 hours, etc. No? And and in the 21, again, Fujimori and Castillo, the one that win, were Castillo win with very little percentage, but he win. And the interesting thing of this president is that he is a rural teacher. He is close to evangelicals, left-wing conservative. At the beginning, it was very difficult for us, because one thing that was very clear is that he win with the vote of the most, the one that never had voice to say about their problem. So he went with a lot of support of the, especially the Andean regions and the more poor people and the part of the Amazon, etc., etc. But he went with a party that's called Perú Libre, Free Peru, something like that. And luckily, it is a party that is from the left, that very conservative, from very, very traditional left, no? The ones that has nothing to do in 21st century, even before. No? So today we have a very complicated situation, in the sense that now they want to make the vacancy of his president only 4 months after he win, because he was only now. Few months ago, he began to be president. He has made a lot of mistakes, in the sense of not coming with people that were a little corrupt without him knowing, I think, we hope. And well, it was very unstable, that is true. But to have a vacancy this moment means, first of all, to go deeper in this crisis of the Peruvian politics since some years ago, and at the same time, given the power to the right wing, because the right wing is the one that is doing all the campaign for the vacancy. To have that the right wing means, for example, for Fujimori, that she doesn't go to jail, because she is now, they are going to put her in jail because of the kind of corruption that she has had with the money for her party and for her campaign in different moments. So, and her organization is called a criminal organization, and she's going to go to the jail. So all this process is just to stop the justice to go further, because they have had the control of the justice, they have had the control of the parliament, they had the control of all these spaces that are looking for democracy, and that would be absolutely, we lost the country forever with the corruption put in the center of the state, because that is the model that Fujimori put, and that's the model that they want. So, and well, what happened with the left in this moment? The problem is that if we have to consider the situation of the left in Peru in a very schematic way, I can tell you about the two streams, to say it in some way. One stream is more democratic left, obviously, putting the thing of indigenous, of poverty, of land, of the rights of women, of abortion, of the sexual diversity, etc., etc., and offering a process of change that is very important, but is not from day to night, because that, as you can imagine, is not possible. And this other left that is much more traditional, the one that I was speaking about that is in Peru possible, that has begun to have a very strong tension with the president, because he said because the left, more democratic left, is the one that is supporting in the Minister of Economy, in the Minister of Women, in the Prime Minister, now is a woman, and like that, there is a group of very well ones that come from this part of more democratic left, and then these other left people accuse them to be a soft left, more near neoliberalism. So the things are inside. And they were saying in a moment that they didn't like the president, and they were going also to go for the vacancy. Luckily, this didn't happen. Luckily, he is the Congress didn't make the vacancy possible, but the situation is not so quiet, in the sense that we have to change a lot of things to go further in this way up, because the right wing, the most strong right wing, it has a lot of money, has a lot of corruption, has a lot of desire to be in the government and defend their privilege, and at the same time they don't want an assembly for new constitution. The constitution that was done in the government of Fujimori in the 90s is one that gives all the benefits to the market, that has problems with the rights of the people, and many other kinds of very dramatic things against democracy. So we have to change it. But the oppositions for changing is the one that really wants to go to put the president out. And as I was saying, Castillo has already won, And it has been very spectacular, the truth, because as I was saying, of what he represents, they ignore people of Peru, and also because we are in this symbolic moment of bicentenary now. So these two things give a kind of more hate to his presidents, but obviously he has to make a lot of changes in the way of dealing, because he has no experience. He is a president in construction, a president that is building himself this time, because he comes from unions and for the rural area. And well, at the beginning, as I was saying, he was very much also strong against abortion, against diversity, against etc. No, but luckily he began slowly to have a much more open idea. He was speaking about from men and women, and not only men, for example, first change. Then he has asked forgiveness to the women, saying, "I didn't think on the parity between men and women in my government, because I didn't know that, but now I am going to try to put it as much as possible." And that means that the changes that have done in the last period has bring almost 5 women in this moment in the minister, and the prime minister also is a very nice, wonderful, young, leftist lawyer, a women lawyer that has been very much involved in the struggles of the people for territory, against mines, etc., etc. So it is that part of the government is going okay, but the other part of the government is not going okay, because it has people that don't have any kind of experience, people that are only come from a union or from the other unions, and or come from the place where he was born. So a kind of very tricky learning to have to be in power in a democratic way, no? In this way. But well, let me see what more I can tell you before going to the second part. And all this with a country in pandemic situation, as you know. But what I want to speak is, as I have tried to tell you, the situation of the left in this moment is it's complicated, because they have tensions now. Because of the vacancy, they come more, there are less tensions, but the situation will continue with that. Because what we have to discuss, not only in Peru, but in the whole Latin America, is really which is the new meaning that we're giving to the left. We are just going to the left as it was at the beginning of the last century, and stay there in a very traditional way, thinking only left as part of taking government, and not the building a different common sense as Gramsci would to do it. No, so I think that if we don't think in a left that incorporates also a core essential way of the dimensions referring to anthropocentrism, patriarchalism, racism, sexism, monocultural coloniality, eurocentrism, etc. No, and confront the authoritarianism, we are not going to change too much. No, so the dispute now is how to define the scope and content of the horizon of the left in Latin America. Also in a moment that is very tricky, because the kind of mobilization, the movements that are acting and going to the streets and confronting and doing, is very important, very, very important. So luckily it's not we are not paralyzed. We are just trying to move as much as possible in the different countries, no? But the problem, as I was saying, is more more dramatic in the whole Latin America, I think, no? Because we only have to remember the progressive governments that were there with many important things that they did in redistribution, etc. But at the same time, they were in Ecuador. Correa was absolutely against the indigenous. He has a lot of confrontation with the indigenous, with the feminists, obviously. He was also extractivist, and he didn't want to make previous consultation with the communities. That is a law. Is a convenium of the OIT, ILO, for defending the rights of the indigenous. Nothing of that. Evo Morales, that also did a lot of interesting things in the moment that he has called for a referendum to see if he can go to a third period. The referendum is against that. He lost. He still goes to the third election with the crisis that we have seen all this time, and the fascist going taking the government, etc. But obviously, the problem is how you can just as a democratic government just go and don't take care of what is the voice of the people in a moment. Also, there's another kind of thing. Also, it's significant that all the progressive governments of this period tried to change the constitution in order to achieve another re-election and staying in power. Mm-hmm. So that is a thing that obviously we have to review. No, but this is these are kind of isolated cases that brings a whole idea of what's happening with the left, but more even, no? There is a maybe you don't know, there is a kind of organization that is called the Forum of Sao Paulo, that is a forum that was done some years ago, where all the left parties of Latin America, the most important ones, began to be there, and they are the voice of the left in Latin America. Well, this Forum of Sao Paulo, for example, defends Nicaragua. And he said that Nicaragua is from the left. And that is not possible because that guy is a dictatorship. O sea, there's no way of putting him in at the level. Also very tricky, Mexico is considered from the left. And I think that it is not as dramatic as Nicaragua, but you have to be careful to consider him from the left. And in the same way, Venezuela is a total, total crisis. And they still are thinking that he is part of the left. And I am saying, no, I am against the anti-imperialism. I am against imperialism going to Venezuela, but I am not supporting the government of Venezuela. And I think that the left has to go farther from anti-imperialism. That is a struggle. But this is not the only one. And that cannot put you blind to all the rest of the things, no? So, all these brief examples, what brings in it at issue is the question of what dimensions the plural horizon of the left encompasses, no? Goes with it, at least here in Latin America. And we believe that it encompasses all dimensions that express injustice, discrimination, exploitation, racism, etc., etc. New forms of labor slavery that are really coming. But at the same time, I think that there is no way, as I was saying, it's not only attacking imperialists or being anti-neoliberals, because a lot of very conservative people that are from the right wing, evangelicals, for example, from these religions that are so radically from the right, they are also anti-imperial. They are also against neoliberal economy. But obviously, we are in a totally different situation because of what? We have to really recover the other part to go further, no? So I think that in order to reflect on what kind of lifestyle we want to, we have to ask ourselves what kind of society we want, what kind of coexistence, how kind of good living contribute, especially to the Anderson, the kind, the interesting thing is that in this moment the left has to open its also its view to what is coming from different worldviews of the indigenous people, of the Zapatistas, of the black organizations that are coming with a lot of strong proposals to change their life. No, so it has to be, it cannot be only a left that is thinking in having the power, because if we don't make a kind of contracultural confrontation, if we don't change the racist, sexist, all this in the daily life, violence against women and all these kinds of things, we are not going to go further. I say no from. So we are, and obviously there is another kind of thing that is absolutely fundamental for us as feminists. We have been very much involved in this intersectional view, in the sense that you cannot isolate the gender exploitation or discrimination with all the other exploitations that women are suffering. But women are different because of that, and that difference has to be part also of the proposal of the left, and obviously it has to be an intercultural perspective, and there's no intercultural perspective in the left in this moment. It's not this horizon of interculturality that is coming. Well, there are some groups, obviously, there's many groups that are in this kind of struggle. For example, I am not in a political party, and I will not, I was in the past, I am not going to be now in a political party. I am from an autonomous movement, but I ask the party just to democratize, to have another kind of way, because otherwise they are not going to have any kind of possibility to really to change the basis of the power and the dominant hegemony, because they are just in the same kind of track in many things. So we need a different party logic. We need the democratization of political institutions and the change of the ways of doing politics also, which is not reduced, as I was saying, to the something that is called balance, no? Vote, not only to the vote, but that recovers the importance of the cultural changes and cultural expressions and intercultural perspectives. No? And this also leads me to place the content of democracy in an intercultural perspective, capable of putting in dialogue or recognition the different experiences and the different knowledge that are coming very clear, very, very, very powerful in this moment in Latin America. No? And then also, because of that, one of the things that is absolutely fundamental in democracy, I think, is to recover the cognitive dimension of democracy. This because today there are different experiences, as I was saying, and cultural matrix, in interaction and dispute, which express paradigms, worldview, diverse and unequal values of knowledge. No? So this idea that Boaventura de Sousa have about the importance of having an ecology of knowledge in our perspective of change, in an horizon of the left, is one of the most important things also, with all the others that I have been saying. Well, I don't know if I speak less or more, but I think.
Thank you very much, Eugenia. I think you have given a very good overview, and I'm sure there are some questions. If you have any questions, please write them either in question and answers or in the chat, because we are opening for this discussion. I asked Virginia to be short in her exposition so we could have time for this discussion, for these questions. And as we are waiting for these questions from the people who are listening to us, I would like to start with a question. You were saying, Virginia, that the new president in Peru was not really prepared, that he is on construction, as you said, in many issues. And I was wondering, you have already mentioned that part of his governor, part of his supporters are very conservative, and that they are, there can be problems with that. You named the situation of feminists and that he's reconsidering this. What, I have two questions. One is, what is the position of the feminist movement regarding this government? Is one of my questions. And the other question is, thinking about the challenges that not only this president, but most presidents in Latin America have to confront, and I mean the challenge of inequality, which is the biggest challenge we have, not only poverty, but inequality. What is this president in Peru's program to fight against inequality? I'm not saying to fight against poverty, but inequality, because as I put you as an example, in the case of Mexico, the president now is absolutely not fighting against inequality. He's not really considering reforms that would be needed to fight against inequality. He's just given the same kind of policies of giving money to some groups of the poor, et cetera, which is not really solving the problems of inequality. So my question is, one, what is the feminist movement's position regarding this president? And the second, what is this president's policy against inequality?
For us as feminists, has been difficult, but I speak of my own, but I am also in different groups of feminists in Peru, but I support the government. I was absolutely against the vacancy because I prefer to have a confrontation with the government about my rights than to have a confrontation with the mafia and the corrupt part of or the right wing, obviously, that wants to disappear all the rights. So this is a risk that we are having. Maybe we are not, maybe things are not going well, but I think that for me, the kind of support that he has gained for coming president is a thing that you cannot see only as a kind of momentary thing. No, it is really half of the country, and half of the country that is not considered country, that is considered the others, that has nothing to do. So there is no way. That is my it's very complicated, because this feeling that I was telling you, that we cannot look patriarchalist on its own, but not all the kinds of articulation that it has with the different ways of power, comes into the case now, no? In the sense that, but that doesn't mean that we are not confronting permanently. No, each of the things that are in discussion, we are just sending things and going to the streets and putting letters, and also with the women that are in the government and the women that from the left and feminists that are in the parliament, we are in permanent connection. We know what is happening, when we have to support the prime minister that they want also to take her out, because she's not only from the left, also she's feminist. And she's very, very, very clever, and they obviously don't want her. So we are supporting the government in that sense, with a critical voice, and at the same time trying to reinforce those forms of acting or resisting that are important for the all the people. No, it is impressive. I have now what and then what have done about inequality? Well, obviously, not yet have the approval of the government, of the Congress. That is another problem. But they are in this moment putting another kind of policy of taxes, no? Mm-hmm. That makes very important things. They are making a much more efforts of decentralization, of not only of power but also of money, and with the recommendation that this goes to obviously to the people. There are a lot of programs that have begun to move in that sense. Inequality is not going to go in 5 years, obviously, but if you have the basic measures that brings a much more equal relation in relation to the taxes, in relation also to what the mines and the big enterprises are paying to the state. They are really paying less than what I pay, I think, well, in comparison with the kind of money, no? And there is a lot of more spaces of participation, and that makes a difference also, because in each of the countries, in each of the places, they are beginning to say, okay, we are having this, we need this kind of thing, we are going to take care of this if there is a law of the government. You have to remember that it's 4 months that he has here only, and these 4 months has been a struggle, totally a struggle. So now it's beginning to be much more clarity of how to go further, no, in this thing. And I think that there's not, we cannot draw the mining activities from the country in this moment, obviously, but we can ask the corporations, the corporations to have another kind of relation with the population, not to put 300 buses all the day with the buses or trucks with the mines going through the community and just killing everything that they have, even children, because obviously there is so much smoke and all these kinds of stuff. So to put only an example, so these are the kind of lack of responsibility of the enterprises and the big transnational corporations, and they have to come to the floor. In the moment that we have that floor a little more equal, it's going to be much more easy to confront much more inequality. Equality doesn't go like that. Inequality of women is also terrible. Inequality of with the indigenous, with the Amazon, what has happened with the pandemic has been, well, very terrible, no? And obviously with that, the women are the ones that have had much more difficulty because they have lost the jobs, etc. No, this is for men and women, but for women, because of her situation, it's worse. And at the same time, the violence against women has grown in an incredible way during the pandemic. And luckily, this government has made a very strong issue of violence against women. So, as you can see, there are things that are moving, and I think that the idea is just to make the floor with institutionality much more equal to have a better possibilities.
Okay. We still have the possibility if any of you want to formulate any question. We still have some minutes left, so please do. But in the meantime, perhaps I continue with my own questions until I see some hands raised or anything like that. But Virginia, you were saying the support for this president comes very much from the Andean region.
And the poor urban
sectors, yes. What about the indigenous groups in the Amazon regions?
Well, It is difficult because the Amazon, in the majority of the Amazon vote for the other candidate, for the but not the communities, but not the community. There is a kind of support in the Amazon of indigenous, but not of the people of middle class or popular sectors, but more urban, etc. Not so much, no? Because there has been a lot of presence of these other forces there, no? And the other thing is that the vote that he has is a vote that is absolutely convinced that this is important, because the kind of propaganda of campaign done by the right, it's really impressive, because it is absolutely full of fake news. They are speaking about only the insecurity. What is the same that's happening in Chile in this moment? Chile has an incredible, wonderful process of building a new constitution, and at the same time, in the election, with little margin, but the right wing, the most right wing, had more potential, no? Luckily, this is not going to happen. It seems that Boric, one of the left, is going to win. But the kind of fake news that I have seen now that I was in Chile was almost the same that the right wing here. That is the style, to put everything. And in a moment, they said, okay, this is not true, but it is all over the place. And people think that it's true. Till the moment that you have to make up other campaign to say no, this is not like that, etc., etc. So that has worked very strongly in this new way of doing politics of the right moment in general in Latin America. Yes.
Okay, and that brings us more into the discussion that you have already taken up regarding the left, because this is a very, very important, and also I think it's a difficult discussion, because you and me, in our own life experiences, have gone through the left for many, many years, and now we see we cannot support, as you said, some of the regimes that are in the region. They are absolutely not acceptable for us. So do you think, I mean, you said that there is a division within the government right now.
Well, this is the, yes, the party, the political party that bring Castillo to the government, to the elections and the government, it's the one that is much more conservative in all these kinds of things, and they want to put their own agenda. The problem is that if Castillo was not there, they didn't win. They have been in the election and have won 1 point and a half of percentage in the last two elections. So it was no way, because Castillo has this kind of voice. Because people were saying, I like him, he speaks as us, he has the same voice. So that is the thing that has bring all this incredible support with reivindication, because it's not it's only support, it's a support, now is our time. No? And what they want is that this time comes to the party and not comes to the not even the government, but to the country. So that is the other kind of thing of the left that is very, very tricky. They think only in the more particular interest of their political situation, the political party, and are not thinking on what is up to open a process of change in the country. So, well, I interrupt you, I think, because maybe you have a more...
No, I was curious because I saw that there were some people who were dismissed from the government that belong in the beginning that belong to this left that you say were conservative. So
I think so. I think that some of them still are there, but Also, Castillo has put some of them that are very bad, and now he's trying to see how he changed. But yes, at the beginning, the prime minister that was put by the party was awful, was really awful, machista, awful, awful. And he was confronting all the time the president, for example. He was insisting in the to change the constitution when that is a process that you cannot do it from the first day. So really, really very, very, very bad. Luckily, he was changed because of these women. And the party still says that we support Castillo, but we don't support the prime minister because she's from the left, soft left, neoliberal left. So the tensions are there. It's not an easy thing. But now, with the vacancy not coming, I think that Castillo has more support, and the party has to come more at ease in this situation. Mm. I hope.
So, in the history of Peru, as I have seen, there have been a lot, as you named before, a lot of problems with the presidents. And some of them didn't finish their term because of these illegalities. And because they were sent to prison or to home prison, etc. So how do you see the future for this president? What is the sustainability of this presidency?
It is very difficult. I think that if he managed to make a more a left center articulation with the parliament could be better, but the problem is that the parliament, all the bloc that is from the right to the wing, they are saying we have not lost, we have only we are going to continue with the vacancy if he doesn't do this and that. So there is a kind of thing in the head. And we are obviously confronting them to not to make again a vacancy. And even the right wing now didn't went to the all the right wing didn't went to the vacancy because it's obviously another vacancy in this period of time when things are so complicated and the pandemic is there, etc. It's absolutely suicide. Mm-hmm. So he said, okay, we have support him because the governability of the country, not because we like him. That is also the other part. No? But he has to see how he moves in this situation. And I hope that the left, democratic left that is supporting him in the government and from the parties, the other party, the left party, can have more influence in the process that is coming.
And my last question perhaps is about the international relations of this presidency. What is the attitude from the United States regarding this presidency or relations of Peru with other countries outside Latin America?
Well, I can tell you about the United States. They have recognized immediately the government, and when it came all this, even some of the right wing went to the United States to have connection with the right wing senators, speaking about the crisis of Peru, etc., etc. Immediately, the United States and their embassy takes a. To put a declaration saying, hey, we are supporting the government. So they are not going to go in that sense. Also, that there is another kind of tension, no? For example, in relation to Nicaragua, the party of Peru Libre supports Nicaragua. And luckily, all the others are trying to put a kind of distance in all these kinds of things. So, and there was something that I was going to tell you that I forget that had to do with the international scene. Well, I think that one of the mistakes of this of the president has been not to be thinking of about the ecology and no how the and we have confront that say you have to be there, etc. But okay, things are not there. So we see in that sense he doesn't realize maybe the importance still of this of these things, no? And yeah, I think that they have sent a ambassador to Venezuela, obviously to all the countries, I think, no? But inside the left, it's very clear the people that are confronting any kind of support to this kind of left that is not left, obviously.
Okay, I have some noise coming from my side. But I think we have to close now, and I'm very, very happy that you could manage to speak to us, Virginia. And I hope to have you again some other time, because after what you have spoken, I'm thinking in loud voice that we have to have a panel discussion regarding the left in Latin America.
Absolutely.
We really have to discuss this issue because it's so important for all of us in all our countries, what is happening with the left in that.
Yeah. Sure. Yes.
So thank you a lot for this. And I'm going to stop this recording. And thank you, those who were here and listening, and I will this link for this discussion, for this presentation, will be available soon. So if you are interested, just write to me to have a link for this recording. Thank you very much, Virginia. And see you the next time. Bye-bye.